I'm Nick Harcourt. This is Guitar Center Sessions. Please welcome our guests, Joan Jett and the Blackhearts. I'm Nick Harcourt. We're here with Joan Jett. First of all, your band kicks. Fantastic.
Thank you very much.
You've been in the business a long time, obviously. 35 years, 21 studio albums, one of the most iconic and recognizable songs in rock and roll history. Do you consider yourself a pioneer?
That's kind of hard to answer. I guess in one sense, yes. But I feel like sometimes putting that moniker on yourself is a little bit conceited. You know, I just try to do what I do, and if it's pioneering, that's great. But for me to call myself a pioneer seems a little egotistical.
But do you recognize your importance in the history of rock music, especially as a female performer, a female guitarist?
I think I recognize the importance of what I've been able to do, yes. But it's hard to say,
you know. How would you describe what you feel you've been able to do?
Well, you know, Ever since I wanted to play guitar, when I was about 13, I asked my parents for a guitar for Christmas. And they kind of thought, you know, that's strange, but they got it for me, an electric guitar, not an acoustic guitar. So they seemed to encourage me right off the bat. So I didn't ever see anything different or why a girl couldn't do this. My parents taught me that girls could be anything they wanted to be in life. So that's the attitude as a young child that I took into life. I wanted to be an astronaut, I wanted to be an archaeologist, I wanted to do all different things. As I grew older, you know, I started to want to act in school. I was in drama and all that kind of stuff. Then around like 13, things shifted. You know, you start listening to more rock and roll, you're noticing the songs like All Right Now by The Free or Bang a Gong by T-Rex, and it's like, I want to make those sounds. So, you know, in that moment, I got a guitar for Christmas and wanted to learn how to play, and went and took a lesson. And the guy said, girls don't play rock and roll. And I was kind of taken aback, but I just sat through the lesson, and he taught me on top of Old Smokey, and I left and bought one of those Learn How to Play Guitar by Yourself books and taught myself to do that. And so, you know, I just never looked at it as being different. I guess growing up in the 70s, it was sort of a feminism, and I didn't think that it would be such a big deal for a girl to try to play rock and roll. But I found out, you know, as I continued and as I met other girls and formed a band, that it was not something girls were allowed to do. And that was just a social thing. It wasn't because they couldn't play.
Do you remember what the first guitar was? Do you still have it?
I don't still have it, but it was a Sears Silvertone.
Why did you pick that guitar?
Well, it was really, I guess, you know, my parents bought it for me for Christmas, so I didn't really have a choice.
You got what came home for Christmas.
I got what they got me. So,
what Santa bought?
It, you know, and I don't really remember what it sounded like, but I spent all Christmas Day just going, boom, boom, just bending strings and making a lot of noise and driving my father crazy, so.
What about punk? When did punk come into it for you?
Punk came into me, my family moved to California. I lived in the valley, both valleys, east and west. And when I lived back east, I used to read Circus magazine. And I read about this club called Rodney's English Disco.
Sure.
So I thought, when I get to California, I'm gonna go to this club. It was all for teenagers. They played a lot of British glam stuff that kids in America never heard. So I would hang out at this club with my friends and heard all the songs we were talking, like Mark Bolan, T-Rex, all that stuff, Bowie, Slade, Susie Quattro. And Susie Quattro having hits, I'm like, well, she can do that, she's having hits in England. There's gotta be other girls in America that wanna do what I'm doing. So that's, you know, that was sort of the genesis of me wanting to form a band. But at the same time, this was 1975, the Ramones were in New York making their first album. And stuff was going on in England that I didn't know about yet. But after the Runaways formed, and our first tour in England was 1976, and I got a chance to go and see The Clash in a small venue. It was probably up in the middle of the country someplace, like Leeds or someplace up there. A small 1,500-seat theater, no seats, and they're playing their first album, and the whole audience is pogoing, you know? That's when the word was before, way before moshing, pogoing.
Sure, yeah,
right?
I remember it.
And I had never seen this, you know, and this was new to me. And so I went over to England kind of dressed as a glam kid and came back to America kind of punked out with this whole new sort of aesthetic that I was seeing in England, and it was very exciting, and I just didn't see that in America. But, you know, it started to pick up as that influence came from England and to bands like the Ramones and, you know, other bands that were being influenced by it. And so, you know, it was kind of happening at the same time. So we kind of went from being influenced by glam to sort of being influenced by punk, which I thought was similar in a way. There were 3-minute songs, catchy, some of them were danceable. And so I saw sort of similar aesthetics in those styles.
Well, I can't stay at home, I can't stay in school.
So when was the moment when you decided you wanted to put together your own band, The Runaways?
That was probably in my mind from the time I got to Los Angeles, you know, thinking, but I had to build my nerve. I was a very shy kid. I could make friends pretty easily, but to go out and perform was probably, it's very scary to me. So I met a few people that I was hanging out with, and this girl that I knew wrote lyrics. And I thought she was in a band. So I said, hey, you want to form a band? I play guitar. She said, no, I don't play anything. I write lyrics. Maybe you should talk to my publisher, a guy named Kim Fowley. So I called Kim very nervously, and I told him I play guitar and I wanted to form an all-girl band. And he asked me a few questions, like, do you have a demo? I didn't even know what a demo was, okay?
How old were you?
15.
Right.
And, you know, so that conversation was over, 20 minutes, and that was that. A couple nights later, the drummer of the Runaways, who became the drummer, Sandy West, who lived down in Huntington Beach, she came up to Hollywood with a bunch of her friends and was hanging out at the Rainbow. Because when the Rainbow closes, everybody hangs out in the parking lot. And somehow Sandy knew who Kim Fowley was. She had been in bands with boys down in Huntington Beach, and so she went up to Kim and said, completely separate from me, this just came out of the blue, that she played drums and she wanted to form an all-girl band. He said, that's really funny because I met a girl the other night who plays guitar. Give her a call. Gave Sandy my number. Sandy called me up. I took four buses down to her house with my guitar, and we set up in her rec room. And, you know, we hit it off right away. She was a great girl and played drums like, I mean, her idol was Bonham, you know, so she played like it. So we played just some rock and roll progression stuff like Chuck Berry, you know, da-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na. Called Kim up and put the phone down and played the stuff, and he said, it sounds great, let's go look for other girls. So we started to put some ads in papers and just started going out to different clubs and, you know, looking around for girls and asking them if they played or if they sang. And so, you know, it was seemed like a slow process, but we were doing gigs pretty much within a month.
So your first demo really was playing in her rec room and putting the phone down.
Yes, yeah.
And he was hearing it over the phone.
Yes.
What was going on in LA at the time? Because I can imagine that as young women, young girls, you were very different from everything else that was going on the Strip.
Yeah, I don't recall what was going on the Strip. It seemed to me at that time disco was really big, and I don't really, because I know that Rodney's closed soon after that, and we had to go to a club called the Sugar Shack, which played mostly, you know, R&B or stuff like that. It wasn't rock and roll. It was maybe pop music, and they would do little sets of the glitter stuff, so that's why we still went to that place. And that's where we found the lead singer of the Runaways, Sheree Curry. She would hang out at that club. So, but as far as the music scene, I really didn't know what was going on in L.A. I was paying attention to what Rodney was doing or, you know, the old records that I was growing up on, you know. I just was listening to that stuff because I didn't find anything new happening in Los Angeles. You know, eventually I heard about the Ramones. Eventually I got their record as soon as I could, and you knew that the scene was starting, you know, and it was very exciting.
So you're operating essentially in a vacuum.
Pretty much, from
the point of view of the music that you were playing and charting your own course, regardless of what was going on around you.
Pretty much, yeah.
When you look back at that, what do you think was going on with you guys as you were putting this band together? What did you want to do?
Well, when I reflect now, I think we all had different goals. You know, I think my goal, and I can't really speak for Sandy, but My, because Sandy passed away several years ago from cancer, the drummer. So I don't know, can't say for sure her motivations, but I think that she was pretty close to, you know, she wanted to prove that girls could play rock and roll. There was nothing weird or different, and if we wanted to be in a rock band, we should be in a rock band, you know? People gave us shit for being sexual. We were trying to just represent what teenage girls are. You know, we were being who we were. So I just wanted to get the message out there that girls, you can do whatever you want to do in this life, regardless if it's rock and roll or if it's being a nuclear physicist. Don't let people tell you what you can do. You go and do what you want to do. If you fail, great, then at least you took a shot.
At least you tried.
If you never go after your dream, that's all you're going to think about for the rest of your life is that you never took that shot. So I say, go for it, man. You really do. So that was where I was coming from. I can't really say where, you know, Sheree Curry or Lita Ford, who's the guitar player, they're, you know, what their motivations for being in the band or what they wanted to do. You know, I thought we all kind of had the same goal, and I think for certain portions of the band, we did have that same goal. But, I think some of it was just looking for something to do.
Where did that attitude come from? The attitude that you have and still have, obviously, as you talk about it, if you want to do something, you should do it. Was that instilled by your parents?
I think it is instilled by my parents. It must have been very young because they told me that as a kid, you know, just you could be what you wanted. And I guess it really stuck. And maybe they didn't know what trouble they were starting, you know. Maybe they didn't live out their dreams. I really don't know. Because I don't have them anymore either. They passed away. But they definitely instilled that work ethic in me and were very proud of, you know, what I was doing, even though they didn't quite understand it.
Spell yourself.
once you did start playing out and once the attention did start coming your way, how did you deal with that as a young woman?
Well, I guess it depended on how people treated us, you know. We were teenagers, of course, and we took a lot of crap for all sorts of things that didn't make any sense, you know, to me. Beyond us people just saying that we couldn't play at all, you know, which it was self-evident that we could play.
Well, that was a big part of it as well, wasn't it, at the beginning? People saying, well, you can't play, you can't write songs, what are you doing? Did that drive you even more?
Yes, absolutely. You know, absolutely. Made me laugh in a way. You know, it was kind of like, okay, we'll show you. We'll show you.
When the success came.
How we dealt with it, yes.
How did you deal with that attention?
Well, you know, in America, it wasn't really success. We put records out, but we didn't necessarily have a hit. We went on the road, we did a lot of press. Some of the press was friendly and tried to understand where we were coming from, and some of the press was very antagonistic and would take shots and try to get us wound up. Some of the bands that we played with, I've been hearing some of them are still talking about it. But, you know, there were definitely some bands that gave us crap on the road.
Right.
And wouldn't give us sound checks. And their crews would stand on the side of the stage and laugh and throw things, paper and stuff, and try to make us trip in our platforms. To me, it seemed very juvenile. So we'd just go up there and try to blow everybody off the stage. You know, I mean, I think as a unit, I felt very, very protective of the Runaways. I still do. Very protective of them. And I just think that we were a really good band that people sometimes didn't get a chance to hear because of the press or whatever. In England, we had a different relationship. We got a lot of great crowds. The press was still a little funny. Sometimes they took shots, but there were a lot of really good writers there that did get it. In Europe, we had a few hits and better reception. In Japan, we were huge.
It was insane in Japan.
Insane, like I don't want to say Beatlemania, but it was similar to that.
Right.
And it was unexpected. And so going from sort of being like, you know, taking the piss out of. And
everyone's
then you
get, giving you crap, and then all of a sudden you're in Japan.
And you get to Japan, and you're like people, I mean, it was all girls, mostly girls, screaming, and they'd come at you with combs and ask you to comb your hair, so they weren't ripping your hair out. They'd want you to comb your hair, and they get pieces of your hair. But it was, I think, kind of frightening for some of the girls, because we'd get in the car, and they'd be rocking the car, and it was really surreal. And I loved it, and it was quite an experience to go into that, make a live album, have the screaming and the cheering, and then, you know, and then come back to the States and have a completely different reaction. So you kind of had to, I don't know, it was hard, you know, you understood it, but you had to put it in each place in its place. You understood that America was a different place than Japan. So it was just, we understood that in Japan, or I learned to understand that girls are much more second-class citizens. So what we were doing over there was really breaking down the barriers of what a girl can do. You know, in Japan, I guess they really weren't allowed to express themselves like that. So when we came over there, that's the reason it was mostly girls.
What was it like being worshipped, I guess, in Japan, and then coming back here and still getting the same old crap?
I don't know. I guess I didn't analyze it too much, you know? I just tried to keep it in perspective, you know? Because I knew that we lived in America. We weren't living in Japan. So our reality was going to be what was going on in America, really. So, you know, we strived to keep making great records and go on the road and do what we were supposed to do and, you know, worked hard and, you know, we did what we did for 3.5 years, and it worked well, and then eventually things started breaking down. You know, different members wanted to go off and do different things, and that's fine. You know, you can't be 20 and be a runaway anymore. I don't hardly know her.
do everything. What a beautiful feeling. Crimson.
You talk about the Runaways, and I've heard different interviews when you're talking about it in an almost reverential term. You're very protective of it. When it ended, was there a dream shattered? How did you deal with the end?
It was devastating. It was devastating for me because I kind of felt like, you know, we'd just grown apart. You know, people wanted to do different kinds of music. I think some of the other girls wanted to go in a heavier direction. Maybe they didn't like the punky direction I was going in. Whatever it was, I did not want to get fired from a band that I started, you know? So we just kind of went our separate ways, and that was it. Our last gig was on New Year's Eve, 78 into 79, and then it was over. And I did not handle it well. I was in bad shape, partying too much. It was my dream was totally shattered, and I just was questioning everything, just questioning, you know, what is this rock and roll is supposed to be free, you know, but now they're telling me that, you know, they've got a regimented thing that girls can't play rock and roll. What are you talking about? Girls play violin and cello and play Beethoven and Bach. What you're saying is girls aren't allowed to play rock and roll because it's socially not acceptable, because when you look at Led Zeppelin album cover, and you see, you know, Robert Plant with his, you know, microphone and holding his shirt open, or you see the Sticky Fingers album cover, you know what they're talking about. They're talking about sex. That's what rock and roll is. And it was just very annoying for this, apparently, America, land of the free, rock and roll, a free music thing, and still taking so much shit. No freedom. No sort of openness. It was a joke. It was a lie. You know what I mean? This whole rock and roll thing. So it was very kind of disillusioning, you know, with the whole business of it was like bullshit to me. So I didn't know what to do. I almost joined the military. I thought, you know, I gotta get my head straight. I gotta figure something out or I'm gonna be dead. So, you know, I thought about that seriously for a couple of weeks, and then I had to do a part in a movie that the Runaways had signed on for before we broke up. And I didn't want to get sued, and so I did the movie with a couple other actresses. And I had to write songs for the film. And we needed 8 songs in 3 days. And so my manager at the time, a guy named Toby Mamus, knew a guy named Kenny Laguna. Now, Kenny Laguna had been in many bands, including Tommy James and the Shondells and 1910 Fruit Gum Company, and he's a songwriter, and he flew out to write songs with me for this movie. When I met Kenny, we hit it off amazingly, you know, like right away, best friends, and we wrote these 8 songs in 3 days, no problem. And I fulfilled my obligation to the movie, and then I was working with Kenny, and I asked Kenny if he would work with me, and he would be my producer and my songwriting partner, and he kind of got stuck being my manager because nobody else wanted to deal with it.
It's usually how it happens.
Yeah. So we started writing songs, and I wanted to get another band together, but I didn't want it to be girls because I didn't want any comparisons to the Runaways,
because
that would start right away. So we put an ad, I forget in what paper, it might have been the LA Weekly, Joan Jett looking for 3 good men. And we found 3 musicians and practiced for a while in LA, and we moved to New York because gig-wise, it made more sense. Because if you live in LA, there's a couple places you can play and get home, and then you've played out the whole area. If you're living in the Northeast, you can play New York, you can play Long Island, you can play upstate, you can play New Jersey, you can play Pennsylvania, you can play Connecticut, you can play all Baltimore, all these places, and still get home. So for a struggling working band with no money, it made more sense to go to New York, and you could hit all these places instead of struggling in California, where you had a lot more land to cover to get to that many people. So we relocated to New York, and the Black Hearts became a New York band.
Now, I know nobody wanted to know. No record labels wanted to know.
Right.
You were one of the first DIY indie artists out of necessity.
Yes.
Obviously. Was there a moment where you're like, screw this, nobody wants to sign us, we just got to do this ourselves? How did that come about, and obviously starting the label?
Well, we wanted to be on a major. We really wanted to be on a major label. And we sent our record, we sent 4 or 5 songs, Bad Reputation, I Love Rock and Roll, Crimson and Clover, Do You Want to Touch Me, maybe one other one, all which turned out to be top 10 hits. We got 23 rejection letters from all the majors and the minors. We still have them,
too. I was going to ask you that.
Oh, yeah. Oh, we have them. You know, you guys need a song search, you know. Maybe she should lose the guitar.
Can't write,
just
can't play.
All, you know, and they're listening to, so I Love Rock and Roll, Crimson, Touch Me, all songs that were hits. So you got to say to yourself, either they can't hear hits, or they're not listening to the tapes, but whatever it is, they completely ignored it. You know, so what are you going to do? We were nervous, and Kenny had just had a young child. You know, he had a 3-month-old baby. He was starting a college fund for her. I'm not sure how much money, maybe he had $5,000 in there. We took that money and we printed up 500 copies of what became Bad Reputation album. And we would sell them out of the trunk of our car at the gigs. And the first 100 flew out, you know, we printed up another 100, they flew. So before you knew it, you know, we had this thing. It became Black Heart Records, started in the trunk of our car. And we were able to create a record label from that. You know, as we got success, as the radio stations in New York actually supported us at the time, in the days when the jocks could still make their own decisions, you know, and we had friends at different radio stations that would play songs off Bad Reputation and, you know, urge people to go out and see us.
We'll be right back.
Take us through the rise of the Black Hearts as things started to take off. Did you feel vindicated?
Very much so, especially once we were getting radio play, or once I Love Rock and Roll hit the airwaves and got out there and was number one. Oh yeah, I definitely felt vindicated to a degree, knowing that all those people that said we were no good, we had no songs, there we were, you know. We did it ourselves. It wasn't even like we had the help of all the majors, you know. We really did it ourselves, scrapping in the street. It was a real do-it-yourself kind of situation. And, you know, I'm really proud of that, and that we've been able to stick to that all these years.
What's it like to have an iconic song like that in your back pocket? I mean, obviously you've had a number of hits, but that one, everybody knows that song.
Yeah, yeah, and I'll tell you, early on I had to make peace with that, because, you know, you're a kid, you have this big hit, you're excited about it, but then that's what everybody's talking about. You want to go, wait a minute, I've got other songs. You know, so I had to kind of understand, I had to stop and go, listen, Joan, this is a big hit. You can't get mad at that, or be sort of weird and have to say, yeah, but look at all these other songs we play. You have to respect what this song is, and thank God it's yours. So, you know, I made peace with the bigness of it. And instead of wanting to go, but we have other songs, just say, thank you, man. Really, you know what I'm saying?
It's kind of like, be grateful for it.
Be grateful, absolutely. So I had to, you know, I had to stop for that second and recognize what was going on, and stop, and instead of being like, hey, to say, wow, yes, I'm grateful. Thank you so much. Thank you for recognizing the song. Thank you.
Did you ever feel pressure to replicate that? To write another song like that?
I didn't, not really. I think it was his own thing. And to try to copy it would be an obvious thing. You know, it'd be obvious, oh, she's trying to copy I Love Rock and Roll. We have a style that is our style, that we use a lot of toms, we're very drum oriented. So I think that's kind of what we try to do, but you can't really replicate that sort of song, I think. It's its own thing.
Did you feel successful?
To a degree, I think then you realize that people are waiting for the next thing. You know, you realize you're successful for a little while.
You've had a string of platinum albums. I mean, you must have felt that you had attained something.
Absolutely, absolutely. I felt that I was living my dream. Absolutely, I was in a rock band, I was touring the world, we were putting out albums. So on that level, yes. But I felt like, I don't know. The audiences are accepting, but I don't necessarily think the business is accepting.
Can you explain that a little bit more? What that means when you're talking about the audience getting it, but the business?
To my point of view, when you do things on your own and you leave out the business people who run things, and you actually have success, it's like, yeah, that's great. Do it again. But you're not going to have our help.
Along to get along.
What about moving into producing, signing other bands? Why did you get into that?
Well, being a music fan, it's just sort of a natural thing. You know, we had a label, and it was something that would be fun if we could help other bands to get a start, put out their record, you know, help get them started. So it would be bands that we would come in contact with. It wasn't a lot. We signed only a few. A band called The Vacancies out of Cleveland, great punk band, which I got a chance to produce their one of their albums. A band called Girl in a Coma from San Antonio, three girls. Really, really interesting, eclectic rock music, and intelligent, and great, interesting lead vocalist who really has a unique style.
What did you get out of that process of working with other artists and helping them to fulfill their dreams?
I think it just sort of takes the fan aspect to a deeper level. You know, I never stopped being a fan of the bands that I was working with. So you just almost go inside the record, you know, and it's, what do I get out of it? Just a good time, you know? It's just a lot of fun to, I guess, transfer what you hear, because these bands I saw live first. So what you see on stage, to try to capture that in the studio is important to me, because that's what I think we try to do, is try to just represent that energy that you're gonna get on stage. Hopefully, when you see it live, it's even bigger. But that's what excited me about these bands. I thought they were great live, and I wanted to capture that on vinyl.
So the passion of being a music fan.
Yeah, pretty much. And being inside that music and helping to get those songs and those lyrics onto tape and then have it come out. You know, I get off on it just almost as much as my own self.
So you have your first new album of material, Unvarnished, coming out. First for 7 years?
Yes.
Two questions. What can Joan Jett fans expect from this after being away for a while? And secondly, why so long?
It's the writing process, you know, sometimes takes me that long. You know, really, I got to a point where people just don't really expect me to make something new. And it's like, I want to be, I know that we have a body of work, but so you can stick with that. You can stay there, or you can try to be current. And I still have things to say. So I wanted to make a new album. But, you know, I got to a point where when I sat down to write, I fooled myself into thinking that things should just flow out. And almost like the song should just come out. And if it's not coming out, you've got writer's block. So I'd get stuck, I'd have a riff, I'd have a line, and I couldn't get past that. And I'm like, I've got writer's block. And one day I'm like, you know what, Joan? The songs never came out all at once. Maybe one or two in your whole life poured out. You got to sit down and do the work. You sit down for as long as you can, 15 minutes, half an hour, whatever it is, each day, and plug away at that song. And before you know it, things started opening up, and I started writing. And this is also the first time that I started writing with the guys in the band. You know, I've been writing a lot with Kenny Laguna, but on this record, I wrote some of the songs with the guitar player, Dougie Needles, and with the drummer, Tommy Price. So that's new and different, and I think some of the subject matter, it's wider than just falling in love, falling out of love, relationships. There is a few of those songs, but...
What drives you today?
Well, you know, I love what I do. I still love what I do. I love to go out and play for people, so that drives me. I'm driven to have success, so I mean, there's always that part of you that wants to put out a record and have it be a big hit. I mean, that's only natural, but that's not the end-all be-all. If that doesn't happen, I'll live and I'll be fine. And I'll go out and I'll play my music and I'll talk about it. But for me, I thought it was an important album to write because it shows, for me, growth. I'm not 18 anymore. I'm now in a different stage in my life. And, you know, to document that and write about that different perspective was important. It's not that different, but it's different. It's just a little bit more grown up, but it's still fun.
It's been so cool talking to you. I'm so happy you came in and played for us and shared 35 years worth of rock and roll history. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you. We had two more hours to do it.
Yeah, right? Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Our guest has been Joan Jett. I'm Nick Harcourt. Until the next time, thanks for watching.